you wanted to put together some a group so that you could, I would think, have a say in how the new leadership is organized.
That's
the
correct.
Division of the committees and
that's,
all that.
That's, but more important, how the agenda can be formed and framed.
All right. But how did you get Senator Onasan's support? He would... People would, the normal thinking or conventional thinking would put him on the side of Senator Enrile.
That's true. Greg is always identified with Senator Enrile. But in this case, Greg and Tito have a pact that they'll vote as one.
Mm.
And Tito has been a long associate of mine.
Mm-hmm.
And he was supported by my party this time. He was not supported by... Mm-hmm. By the LP,
so but
he's inclined.
NPC, but he was with the NPC.
He's with NPC, and he was supported by the LDP.
By the LDP.
Yes.
All right. So he's with you.
He's with me.
So he brings Greg with him.
He brings Greg now.
And the Lacas, why are they with you, Senator Revilla and?
Because they have
Senator
been they have been my black mates, even during this past Congresses. Mix Subiri, Senator Bong Revilla, and Lito Lapid.
Oh, I forgot Senator Subiri. But we are told that one reason why he is with you is because of the Electoral Tribunal. I think, is it you that sits there?
I'm the one who sat there.
So is it
but
because
I'm only one of six senators who sat there, who's sitting there.
So that's not that's not the reason why he's with you.
No. Because we. I think we're, in a way, soulmates in terms of legislative advocacy.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Mix is a trained agriculturist, and I like agriculture.
Yes, that's been your interest.
Yes.
Why would Senator Soto not go for Kiko, who is, in a way, a relative by... By affiliation.
By affinity.
Yeah. Affinity, rather.
Yes. Well, I don't want to be the one to provide the explanation. But
the
I
analysis.
Know.
But
yes,
there's a reason.
There's a reason.
Supposedly, Chris, the sister of the president, has been supposedly wooing him to support Senator Pangilinan. Have you heard that?
No. This is the first time.
So he's committed to you?
Yes. He's committed. He's committed to the bloc.
Mm-hmm.
To our
to the bloc.
Yes.
Okay.
Whoever we decide to support, every one of them will go.
Those who are with you, for instance, Senator Onasan, it's contingent on Senator Enrile not going after the vote.
Yeah, that's correct. That's
so
correct. That's,
it could
he made
change.
That very clear.
Mm. Has Senator Enrile indicated whether he would make another try?
No. In fairness to him, he has never solicited any support from any one of us. But, you know... We don't want a vacuum to occur because a vacuum can very well happen if the two sides just stuck to their guns.
Right.
No one crosses over.
There's a standoff. Yeah.
There's a standoff.
Yeah.
No one crosses over.
All right.
And you will see that there is no 13 in favor of supporting one leader. And that's I think, an occasion for a person of prominence and ability like Senator Enrile to be considered as a compromise.
He just might emerge.
He might just emerge as a compromise.
Mm-hmm. And if that happens, all bets are off.
All bets are off.
All these alliances will
But as you know,
collapse.
Says, Senate politics is really alliances. Mm-hmm. That
very temporary.
Well... In a way, that's true. In a way, that's true. Unlike in the House, na talagang, kung manalo ko dyan, marami.
Mm-hmm.
By 10, 20, 30 congressmen.
Mm-hmm.
Sa Senado, manalo ka isa o dalawa. Mm-hmm. So it's very fragile.
Mm-hmm.
It's very fragile.
So even if you sit there, Senate President, your hold
you're sitting on
it may
an easy chair.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You would know that, no?
Yes.
Having been there.
Yeah.
But what is... The reason why one way may aspire for the Senate presidency is because you set the legislative agenda when you're
because
sitting.
Because you have a big say on the legislative agenda. Mm-hmm. And the reason we maintain our group is because we want to have an influence on the content of that agenda. because we are all keen, really, to push for reform.
All right. Well, we'll go into that. But I'd like to ask you also, based on your talks with Senator Villar, what is your reading of his approach? Will he be, well, because of a very rough campaign that was waged, how will he deal with the administration?
Yeah, that's a good question, because that's one of the things we also I ask him, given this bitter campaign you've just gone through. What if you become Senate President? What is your relationship with the administration? And he was very, very frank. He said, "No, I'm not going to be a confrontational head. We'd like to help if we can, but we don't want also to be pushed, because when we are pushed, then we push back." That's more or less his approach.
Okay, but what is he, what would he like to prioritize if he were to be at the helm?
I think he likes to prioritize more on more the infrastructure and the housing and the agriculture.
So it you have in a way a meeting ground.
On that basis, yes.
What is your what is it that you'd like to push? You said that you want to shape somehow what comes out of the Senate.
You know, in the last Congress, practically all the financial reform was
passed through your committee
and sponsored by me, authored by me. The PERA, the personal equity, that's a voluntary pension fund. The REIT, the Real Estate Investment Trust, that's probably one of the most attractive financial measures attracting foreign investors. The amendment of the PAGIBIG, the amendment of the PDIC, the passage of the pre-need code affecting the pre-need industry. So those are sets.
So you've set all the regulation.
That's right. But there is one big change and measure that we ought to pass, which is the modernization of the DSP charter.
You know,
the central bank charter was passed in the mid 90s.